solid professional wrestler, but for some reason my knuckles always get swollen up. I can't get my hand loose every time I put a full Nelson on somebody. I don't know if I'm just putting too much pressure or what. But if Paterno want to come here to Georgia to wrestle, then I'd be more than glad to climb in the ring with him, because Paterno, you big and you strong, but all that, it make me fearful in a way, but then again, it kind of make me happy because I know I'm going to get competition. I'm boned to challenge people. I'm boned for competition. If they turn Willie B or loose out there at the Atlanta City Zoo, that's that gorilla they got out there. I'll wrestle him if you get in that ring, because that's what the contract called for.
Fair enough. Tony Atlas, thank you so very much.
All right.
There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. An outstanding man, Tony Atlas, talking about outstanding individuals, giving him his due. He is wild. He's unpredictable. I'm referring, of course, to Abdullah the Butcher. He is now being managed by the Great Mephisto. I thought it might be interesting to all of you to hear these comments from the Great Mephisto and take a look at this man, Abdullah the Butcher.
Well, as you see, Abdullah the Butcher and the Great Mephisto has joined me here. As I understand it, you, sir, are now the manager of Abdullah.
Yes, I have taken over all the managerial contracts of Abdullah the Butcher. But I would like to take just a moment to properly introduce myself. My name is Fawzi Habin Mahab, better known the world over as the Great Mephisto. I am an international wrestling star within my own right, the former United States wrestling champion. Now, the man that I am managing now, one of the men I should say, is one of the most renowned, one of the most outstanding wrestlers in the world today, known as Abdullah the Butcher. This man is 346 pounds of mental and muscular coordination. This man is a human destruction machine. The Arab sands will turn green with grass before this man, under my management, will go without acquiring, and this is a promise that I'm going to make, and Mephisto doesn't make any promises that he can't back up. The Arab sands will turn green with grass if this man doesn't become the next world's heavyweight wrestling champion. He is the greatest attraction. And you know, I would like to say, and this goes without verification, this man right here is one of the most misunderstood men in wrestling. Now, next to my homeland, Saudi Arabia, such a country called Sudan, I understand the temperament of these people. I speak the language of this man. I can control this man.
Well, there you have it, the comments from the Great Mephisto, who now manages Abdullah the Butcher. And of course, anytime Abdullah the Butcher is in that squared circle, his opponent is in for a lot of trouble. Abdullah the Butcher, a man who appears to be almost impervious to pain, a man who has nothing in his mind at all but to destroy and destruct his opponent as quickly as possible in the ring. He metes out a lot of punishment to a lot of people. But you know, you're talking about sometimes the irresistible force meeting the immovable object. And I'd like to have you hear some comments right now from a very, very good friend of mine. And may I just say, he's a master wrestler and a rap master. Certainly no question about it. We're going to hear some comments now from the American Dream Stardust himself, Dusty Rhodes.
There's one thing in the Southeast, no matter where you go, where it's at. There's one thing all over the world, no matter where you go, where it's at. Every major network, every major TV station, every major place, from New Orleans to Hawaii to Atlanta to Marietta, all up and down the East Coast, all over the world, Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream. Heavy demand. Heavy demand for the man. Looking fine on the TV monitor, Dusty Rhodes. And when you start talking about bad, when you start talking about things is past, I start thinking about parking lots. I start thinking about tattoos. And I start remember laying on some cold floors, you know, and getting up, picking myself up. Getting drove to be the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, the tower power. Tell it like it is what they say. Dusty Rhodes, they tell me, go out and tell it like it is. Well, I'm going to tell you like it is. In Atlanta, I'm there. Abdullah the Butcher, it might as well be the baddest. I'm glad it's the baddest. Because when Dusty Rhodes returned to Atlanta, I wanted to be the baddest. And Abdullah the Butcher is the baddest. And in the Omnet, with my thousands and thousands of fans and all my pretty ladies waiting on a dream to get shot and finished, Abdullah the Butcher, we got business. In the Omnet, we got heavy business.
Gordon Nelson. Gordon. Wrestling number two, I hope you're paying attention. I hope everybody's paying attention. This belt here belongs to me, nobody else. It's mine, you understand? Not any one of these guys, or anybody in this area, or anybody in professional wrestling is gonna take this belt. Wrestling number two, Tommy Rich, Muscle Man Tony Atlas, Travis Sullivan, this is my belt, and I'll hold on to it as long as I want to. You gotta come through me. You gotta defeat me. You've gotta hurt me if you can. This is mine, fellas. There's a lot of destruction down the road. There's a lot of heartache down the road. There's a brick wall at the end of the road, and that's me. And you're not gonna get through it.
Well, I'll tell you what. Tomorrow night at the Omni, you'll be defending the title against the challenge of wrestling number two.
Wrestling number two's been a thorn in my side for months and months and months. Wrestling number two, what we have is a failure to communicate. I took your mask right here on television. Tomorrow night in the Omni, you better tie it on with barbed wire. You better put it on there with a strap so it won't come off in the first minute. Because wrestling number two, I'm gonna go down your throat, tear your insides out, and walk away with a white mask.
Television admitted that the superstar had paid him to masquerade as wrestling too. This man has decided to stay within the ranks of professional wrestling, but I understand that you did have a few things you wanted to make clear today.
That's right, Gordon. You know, I have always wanted to be a professional wrestler. And when I was approached by the superstar and he offered me $5,000, this was my opportunity to do what I had always wanted to do. And you know, money makes a man do a lot of things. And after I had accepted the money and had done the things that I had done, I realized it began to bother me what I had actually been doing to the reputation of Mr. Wrestling Number Two. And the more I thought about it, you know, it really made me feel bad because I cannot apologize to the man enough for what I had done. And it's like I told Mr. Wrestling Number Two that I would not wrestle as Mr. Wrestling Number Two anymore. And I made him a promise to this effect, and that I would pull this mask off. And that's what I'm gonna do.
All right, sir, then go right ahead. That's just... Wait just a minute. Let me get out of the way from this. But, this man was charged by, Rick Craven. Craven catches it now. And, caught him with a high backdrop. He closes in on him once again. And he sets, delivers that high, high knee lift, puts Craven to the canvas. And that's all she wrote. That is all she wrote. And wait a second. Now the superstar in there. The superstar in there has, after the mask of this man who has been masquerading as wrestling too, now the superstar after catches him coming off the ropes. The superstar has him on the canvas, and now the superstar. Catches him again, coming off the ropes, and now has the cobra hold on him. He has the cobra hold on him. Craven outside the ring is out of action, but now the superstar has this man in serious trouble with that... with that cobra hold. And he is continually clamping the pressure on that cobra hold. And he's got some real problems here. This man has been hurt. His neck has been hurt. There's no question about that. He still has that hold on him, and he is refusing. Now, wait a minute. Through the referee aside. And reapplied the cobra hold. He has thrown the referee to one side and has reapplied the cobra hold. Wait just a second. Wrestling 2 has charged the ring. Wrestling 2 has charged the ring. And the superstar has exited the area. Wrestling 2 charged the ring, and it is the superstar.
I'm sorry, that's the only thing this guy's good for.
Watch out! Watch out! Watch out! Superstar charged him from behind. Superstar has completely torn that jacket off him. The superstar has Wrestling 2 on the canvas. Or on the concrete, rather. He's got him. Wrestling 2 charges hard. Catches the superstar. He's got the superstar on the concrete outside. Wrestling 2 catches him again. And it's Wrestling 2 pounding away. And the superstar has fled the scene. The superstar has fled the scene. And Wrestling 2... Wrestling 2. Well, I don't know what to say at this juncture. I'll tell you one thing. There is absolutely no call. There is no call for a man to come out here and attack anybody. There is a ring where people can wrestle. It certainly should not be done out here on the floor. And obviously, Wrestling 2 is not in a position to talk right now.
It's getting to the point that something's going to have to be done. You know, the superstar, he's incensed. He's got that belt. He's incensed with hurting somebody. Well, superstar, I know wrestling number 2. I know this man right here. And I know what that Georgia belt means to him. He just come home to Georgia. And he come home for one thing. That's winning. Not somebody running up behind him and jumping on him. Superstar, I think you done bit off a little bit more than you can chew, brother.
Superstar is going to get it, pal. Let me tell you, Superstar, I'm coming after you. You want some communication, you're going to get some communication. I'm telling you that right now, pal. I'm going to bring the fight to you. I'll ram that down your throat. This type of thing is uncalled for. The man is a punk as far as I'm concerned. He's not a man. He's nothing. Superstar, I'm going to tear you apart. I'm going to have to chase you to the end or...
Let me just say this, that at the Omni tomorrow night, I'm going to personally introduce this match, Wrestling 2 against the Superstar, the Georgia Heavyweight Champion.
That's going to happen, I can guarantee you. And tonight in Carrollton, it's going to happen there too. Superstar, you're there. I'm there. A lot of people in Carrollton tonight. And Carrollton's going to get his dues. And so is Atlanta. The Omni, I'm going to get you. It was the last thing I do. From here to time to anywhere you want.
Well, 1980, it's got it all right here. You know what, that's right.
It sure does, Tommy. I'll tell you something, but what happened here on the floor just now is something that, very frankly, there ought to be something done about it.
Like Wrestling 2 said, it's uncalled for. It's not wrestling, and I don't blame 2. I'd be fired up, and I know he is, and I know he'll get him.
Well, I certainly think that's going to be the case. Tommy, another thing, too. This man, the superstar, is so deadly, so efficient with that cobra hold. And I don't know how badly that imposter number 2 was hurt, but it was obvious when they took him out of the ring, he was hurt.
Well, you know, I have a little respect for that. You called him imposter 2. You know, that was a man right there. He just had a lot of respect for Wrestling 2, and he got off on the wrong track. But he was a man. He come out here, and he stood up, you know, and he said he apologized to Wrestling number 2 the whole bit. So, you know, I've got a little respect for the guy. And then guys like the superstar, first, he took advantage of the guy. The guy didn't know what was going on, so Superstar gave him a little money to try to get him to hurt, too. So I got respect for the man, and I want to wish, too, all the luck in the world.
Thank you so very much, Tommy. I want to take a moment now to talk further to Lars Anderson.
Well, I think it's terrible. I mean, the Anderson brothers have done everything possible in professional wrestling, but that's ridiculous. The man jumped him from behind. He jumped in the ring. He didn't belong there. I hope that Wrestling 2 tears that mask off and runs Superstar out of the state of Georgia and out of the U.S. as far as I'm concerned.
Well, some very strong comments from... Talk to Tommy Rich about some of the things that are happening here in the state of Georgia, and more particularly right here on Channel 17. Tommy Rich, Tommy, of course, what we saw, and we're going to take a look at it a little bit later on in the program, is when Superstar attacked Wrestling 2 from behind, and I can assure you of one thing. I am going to see to it that the proper people are informed of the situation and action taken.
You know, I tell you, the excitement's there. You know, it's bad to see, but this thing, it's got so keyed up. You know, there's two men insist on one's going to get the other's mask, and it's so keyed up right now. You know, it's a tricky situation. One will do anything to the other, you know, but I'm putting my money on Wrestling number 2, you know. I've been out here, you know, I've been here through a couple of changes. I've seen a couple of new years right here in Georgia. You know, the people's still the same. And as a matter of fact, they're behind me more, you know. They're always there, win, lose, or draw, you know. And I'm just looking forward to 1980. And like I said, you know, I've been getting fan mail from Porterdale, Douglas, Georgia. You know, when are you going to wrestle the superstar? When are you going to wrestle Austin Idol? Well, I'm going to be in all them towns. I'm going to be wrestling all through that area. And some of the towns I've been getting there, you know, like at 8 o'clock and signing autographs and everything, had a little table. And that got out, you know, it did real good. I was in Porterdale last week, and the people, you know, they really weren't crazy. I loved it, and I'm looking forward, you know. But the biggest thing, Gordon, 1980, you know, right here it is. You know what that is?
That's, I hope, your contract.
Yes, sir. You know, they even let me carry it around to me, with me, too. You know, they're right there. I started 1980 off, you know, the superstar. I couldn't get a title shot. I couldn't get a shot at Harley Race because I had to have the belt. But Harley Race, he put a little bounty out on me. So the promoters there in Columbus, Georgia, they said, well, if he can put a bounty on you, if you can beat his bounty man, we'll give you a contract. When Harley Race comes back to Georgia, if you beat Ernie Ladd's, who I wrestled, that's who was after me. I beat Ernie Ladd in Columbus, Georgia, Harley Race. Now then, I'm looking for you. I've got my contract. So you bring yourself back to Georgia. It can be in Atlanta, Augusta, Columbus, anywhere in Georgia. Because just like I said, all of these people of mine, you got some beautiful people here in Georgia. You know, the world heavyweight champion. And right here in Georgia, you know, I can't, you know, I'm a Tennessee boy, that's where I'm from. But if I won the belt, right here to Georgia is where I'd bring it. And I'm looking forward to that. Right here's a start. I'm looking forward to 1980, and I just want to thank all the people.
Thank you so very much. Tommy Rich looking to gain that world heavyweight championship. I might point out that we're going to have a most impressive demonstration following this important message. Impressive demonstration. I have watched this man, Toru Tanaka, do this in the past. He is currently managed by Gorgeous George Jr. Exactly what will we be seeing?
Well, as you see right in front of you right here, Gordon Soley, you have 1 inch boards, which Professor Tanaka, we call him Professor Tanaka because he is the teacher of the martial arts. He will strike these boards with his elbow, some with his head. He will break blocks with his head, and it's going to really be something impressive, and it's something that I want all you millions of fans out there to view for free. You don't have to pay to come to see this, and I know there's a lot of shut-ins that need to see something like this, and out of the kindness and goodness of my big heart, this is what I want to do. So at this opportunity, I'd like to bring in the professor and let him demonstrate to you. Excuse me, Gordon.
Sure.
But I will talk to you as he is doing this.
These are all solid boards here.
Very solid boards.
Well, I can certainly see that, yes.
See yourself. Tanaka right now is setting himself. He is concentrating deeply. That's American boards right there. And he says American boards are number one good. You know, you can take a big man and you can have him do something like this. And possibly a real huge man could do this. But a man Tanaka's size, who is 285 pounds, and you consider him a big man, can do it with just a slight snap of the elbow. Watch his head now. Can you imagine anybody in their right mind signing a contract to step into the ring to wrestle against the master? This is four with the head right now. Would have to be completely out of their minds. I hope you people out there in TV land are enjoying what you are now seeing, because this is one of the rare times that he will do this. Now, you see right what we have right here, Mr. Soley? We have a solid 2-inch piece of cement block, and Tanaka is going to do something really remarkable right now.
Well, Toru Tanaka apparently getting set to break the concrete.
That's a very good observation. With his head. Watch closely now. Many times, Tanaka.
Using the elbow very effectively and...
Number one break, it is number one top. But I know what happened when I do something to opponent. with opponent's head, the body, bones, and not like a brick.
See, one thing about Professor Tanaka, before he begins to be one of these type of individuals, he studies the human anatomy. He finds out where certain vital organs are in the body, and then he learns and learns, and he knows just when. There's certain times of the month, there's certain times of the year that certain organs of the body are more vulnerable than at other times. And this is the why they call him Professor Tanaka, the master of the martial arts.
Thank you so very much, Gorgeous George Jr. We have a match coming up now with Killer Khan. So at this point in time, let's turn it over to our ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match will be one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Now entering the ring from Mongolia, weighing in at 285 pounds, Killer Khan. Killer Khan, managed by Gorgeous George Jr. His opponent from Atlanta, Georgia, weighing in at 210 pounds, Gerald Finley. Referee is Jack Singletary.
All right, so we're going to see another of Gorgeous George Jr.'s men in action now. I'm referring, of course, to Killer Khan, a man from Mongolia. Tanaka, of course, is from Japan. And I must say, most impressive demonstration. And so it is Finley. God, it's Khan with a go-behind. Good escape by Finley. So Finley, moving well. And it is Khan now getting the physical advantage over Finley. Finley fighting his way back to his feet now. Steps over, good escape all the way, and Khan steps back somewhat befuddled by the capabilities of Mr. Finley. Khan, obviously irate over the situation with Finley, moves in once again, collar and elbow. Finley catches him on the break, being warned by the referee, and I can't say that I blame Finley, however. Khan closes in once again, back of the elbow, to the middle of the back of there you see Tanaka and Gorgeous George Jr., watching very carefully. A series of boots to the back of Finley. Catches him again. And so Khan. Hey, Finley fires back to the midsection. Double chop. And it is Finley firing back with everything he had that staggered Khan momentarily. Finley closes in again. Finley whips him up. A flying drop kick caught him on the shoulder. Into the ropes now. And it is Khan administering some punishment. Finley caught again by that Mongolian boot of Killer Khan. Killer Khan brings him up. A full body slam. Finley in a lot of trouble now. Count of two. A count of two. Did not get the count of three. Finley whipped up by Khan again using that elbow. Finley trying to get to his feet. Again, that Mongolian boot to the side of the head. Khan crashes down across the chest. Yeah. and Finley. Before that count of three brings him up. Khan using that top ring rope, Finley was able to block it partially. Again, Finley caught on that top ring rope. Killer Khan continues to punish. Catches him in the midsection that time with a knee. Finley catches the base of the skull. Gorgeous George Jr. issuing instructions. Finley caught coming off the ropes. Again. He goes in for the claw. He has the claw hold. And people just don't get out of the way of the claw. They just don't escape from that. Finley trying desperately to hang in there, but Khan holding onto that claw hold. Brings him up into the air. And still kept the claw hold. The count of three, it is all over. Khan, there you see gorgeous George Jr. moving into the ring. And Khan will not relinquish that hold unless gorgeous George Jr. tells him to. That's the understanding they have. He finally relinquishes it, and so Killer Khan is victorious, obviously, in this match. And we have quite a combination when you take a look at Toru Tanaka and Killer Khan as a tag team combination. You're talking about a dangerous combination indeed.
Can you folks out there in TV land believe that anybody in their right mind would sign on the dotted line their name committing suicide by stepping into the ring with two, the professor of the martial arts and his number one student, Killer Khan? When they step into the ring, they have done nothing but told their families, goodbye, we'll see you again someday, I hope.
Indeed, you sound that confident. But may I just point out that tomorrow night in the Omni at 7:30, you'll have a chance to find out how tough they are.
Anderson, it's been a while since you've been together. Why did you want to do something like this? Sign the dotted line. I will not be held responsible if you lay there and are not being a, will not be able to get up on your own.
We'll find out at the Omni tomorrow night. Heard the comments by Wrestling 2.
Listen, I've heard Wrestling 2 blow off many, many times. You know, I'm beginning to like collecting these things. They say if you want something done right, you better go ahead and do it yourself. And that's exactly what I plan on doing. Now, Wrestling number 2 and the imposter who allegated that I paid him to do this or do that, you both lost something, fellas. I haven't stopped. As Paul Jones, the Navigator, said, I have not yet begun to fight. I'm going to go through Wrestling number 2. I'm going to take every one of these that you've got. I hope you've got a lot of them, because I'm coming right at you. There's not enough room in professional wrestling, let alone in this area, for more than one masked man. And I'm the champion here. I'm the dictator of this area. And whatever I say goes, and whoever I say goes. For Wrestling number 2 and Tommy Rich and Tony Atlas, I don't care who you are. You're looking at the main dog right here. I'm the individual who's going to dictate what happens when it happens.
Well, tomorrow night at the Omni, I will introduce this man as the Georgia heavyweight champion as he takes on Wrestling 2.
You're going to introduce me and you're going to see me go through Wrestling number 2. Right here's communication. You're right, 2. Right here's the whole message. You're coming after me. But now it's turned around. I'm coming after you. I thought I got rid of you one time. Now I'm going to finish you. A masked man without the mask is nobody. A has-been. And you're going to be done.
And here's a special word of interest to all wrestling fans.
110 pounds, Sammy Hall. Sammy Hall. His opponent from Boston, Massachusetts, weighing in at 230 pounds, Kevin Sullivan. Kevin Sullivan.
Kevin Sullivan moving out against Hall. Sullivan, the orange and white trunks, and it was Hall. A quick attack on Sullivan at the bell. Sullivan retaliating very quickly. Sullivan a snapmare. Sullivan brings him up. Body slam, crashes down with that elbow, and Sullivan moving on his man very quickly. And he's using the inside of the fist. Sullivan using a boot to the chest. Sullivan with both feet into the stomach of Hall. Sullivan now using that spinning toe hold. And he concedes. He concedes very, very quickly. And so Kevin Sullivan, in a very quick victory indeed over this man, Hall. I want to take a moment to talk to Kevin. Obviously, you and Steve Travis have formed quite a tag team combination. We're going to be having the U.S. Tag Team Tournament here on television in the near future. I imagine you two are looking forward to being here.
Yes, I am, Gordon. This man is a great athlete. He's a great man to have in my corner.
Steve, of course, in just a few moments, you're going to be stepping into that ring to defend your television championship against the man that you defeated, Austin Idol.
That's right, Gordon. And, of course, I'm very excited about that match and also nervous. The main component of a champion is somebody that's not afraid to get in there and defend that title. And I want to show the people I'm not afraid to defend it. So I'm going to go out there and give it my best. But I'd like to say something about this man right here. We've got a big match coming up in the Omni tomorrow. And we go back a long way together. And I know that I can depend on Kevin when the going gets tough against Austin Idol and Eddie Mansfield. And I know what occurred between Kevin and Austin Idol. And I'll tell you what, I promised Kevin I'm going to see to it that he can get in that ring with Austin Idol and square things.
Well, of course, all of this action, as you said, will take place Sunday in the Omni in Atlanta. Match time, of course, is 7:30. We certainly hope that all of you make your plans to be there. Don't forget the Superstar against Wrestling 2 for the Georgia title. Now, let me just ask you this question. I can remember a while back, in Florida, in Tampa, when you and Mike Graham were a tag team combination. I remember when you won the Florida Tag Team Championship. And what I'd like to do, if we may, is take a look at something that a most unusual turn of events. But I'd like to take a look first at this match when you two were going after the Florida Tag Team Championship. You were facing the Lewis brothers. Dale and Gene Lewis are a very, very tough combination.
The youngest of the Lewis brothers, recently turned professional, but Sullivan and Graham are giving away a lot of age and experience to Dale Lewis. Good forward leg trip, and Lewis on the canvas now. Kevin Sullivan keeping that hammerlock. Opening moments of the match, the Florida Tag Team Championship at stake. Graham and Sullivan have been defending this championship with a great deal of regularity against any and all comers. And this presents a real, real tough challenge to them. Tag is made. Mike Graham moving into the ring now against Gene Lewis. Mike Graham keeping that hammerlock now. Lewis trying to break it if he can. And Mike Graham maintains his offensive posture against Gene Lewis. Lewis makes it to the ring ropes. Referee forces the break. And Graham, very cautious now, backs away. Eyeing this young Gene Lewis, obviously with a great deal of respect. And now Dale Lewis, well over 270 pounds, moved in the ring. Twice in the U.S. Olympics, going up against Mike Graham, tipping the scales at 221 pounds. I just mentioned, though, that Mike is an extremely powerful man, probably one of the most powerful young men in the state of Florida. He'll bench press over twice his own weight, 440 pounds. Mike Graham trying to break that side headlock. And now watch. The great power, tremendous power, as Mike Graham begins to power his way out of this side headlock applied by Dale Lewis. And Lewis now, using a tactic somewhat unethical, manages to get Mike Graham back into that side headlock. Referee double-checking with Dale Lewis, issuing a warning. Mike Graham still trapped in that side headlock. The Florida Tag Team Championship at stake. And again, Mike Graham beginning to power his way out of that side headlock.
Very rarely will you see a competitor able to power his way out. And now Bedlam starts to break loose. Mike Graham tags up with Kevin Sullivan, and Kevin Sullivan moves in. That's Gene Lewis. And Sullivan, throwing caution to the wind, pounding away with both hands now against Lewis, driving Lewis to the canvas, and now Dale Lewis caught with a roundhouse. He moves in, and Mike Graham catches him. Mike Graham moving into the ring as Dale and Gene Lewis double-teaming against Kevin Sullivan and Graham.
Of course, you went on to win the Florida Tag Team Championship, Kevin. It was early the next morning that you and Mike signed to meet the World Tag Team Champions, and less than 5 or 6 hours after that, suddenly you called Mike, you canceled all your engagements, you canceled the Tag Team Championship, and left. Really, I think a lot of people have wondered over the years just exactly what happened.
Well, Gordon, there's only a few people that know, Mike, myself. I've told Steve and a few other people. And what has happened to me was a very personal thing. And, Gordon, I mean, I just don't think right now that I should go and tell everybody, because I would like to get this thing done and away with and not have to tell the whole story, because it was such a personal and embarrassing thing to me and people that are close to me.
Well, of course, it did involve Austin Idol, no question about that. May I just say that I've talked to your father. Hopefully, I'm going to have your father on the program next week, and I understand how and why you feel so sensitive about it. But, gentlemen, thank you so very much, and we'll be back in just a moment.
Division champion, he is now the challenger. He'll be going into that ring momentarily to try and regain that title.
You know, I hear people come out here and talk about how great they are and how famous they are. Well, if everybody around here is so great and so famous, then why is it that every arena that Austin Idol appears here in the state of Georgia, you hear people screaming, Austin Idol, we love you. Idolmania, Idolmania. Go, Austin, go. Go, Austin, go. And that's exactly what I'm going to do tomorrow night in that Omni. You know, Sullivan, you've jumped in my matches too many times. You've caused me embarrassment. You've caused me humiliation. You've caused me degradation. And now it's time for somebody to get hurt, and somebody to get hurt bad. You have yet to feel the wrath, the power, and last but not least, the fury of Austin Idol. And when I clamp my Las Vegas leg lock on you, Sullivan, I'm not going to break it till I see the bone pierce through your leg.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a title match for the Georgia Television Championship. One fall with a TV time limit. Introducing the challenger from Las Vegas, Nevada, weighing in at 242 pounds, the universal heartthrob, Austin Idol. Austin Idol. His opponent from Virginia, weighing in at 240 pounds, the TV champion, Steve Travis. Steve Travis.
Steve Travis, holder of the television championship. And in essence, really, it's a national television championship. Steve Travis, an all-important match for both of these men. I have to admire Travis. He gave him an immediate rematch for the title. Waistlift takedown by Idol. Travis sitting out trying to escape. Turns to his man, and Idol could not maintain the ride. Steve Travis, back on his feet, a good escape. There was, of course, a rematch clause in the contract, and Travis would have had 30 days, but he said no. I beat him once. He wants to prove beyond a shadow of a doubt it was no mistake. Champion catches him in a head scissors. Idol powers out. Arm drag takedown by Travis. Idol caught in another arm drag takedown. Travis in the wine red trunks. Austin Idol in the black trunks with the red boots. Travis keeping the arm bar. Television championship on the line. Travis admitted that he was somewhat nervous about this match. I think that was a good, healthy, honest admission on his part. And it's all or nothing for Austin Idol, no question about that. Oh, Travis driving, and he's the Travis now. Really concentrating on that left arm of Austinitis. He can take away that point of attack, that point of balance, and Idol has his problems now. Travis, keeping the hammerlock. Idol, good reversal by Idol. Takedown by Idol, although he had some extra leverage. Referee called for the break, and Idol protesting, but Travis closing in on him very quickly. And Travis uncorked a hard right hand, uncorked another hard right hand, and Travis, irritated by the tactics of Austin Idol, catches him again, and Idol has some problems now. And so the television champion, moving extremely well against the challenger, and of course time is on Steve Travis's side. Time is on his side. Again, Travis rolls out before Idol is able to get him into a pinning three combination. Austin Idol cross-facing on Steve Travis, trying to break that side headlock. Idol fires him off. Travis got him a good shoulder smash. Caught him coming down, and it was Travis rolling out of the way. Travis closing in. Travis with a side headlock. Travis. Ooh. Idol drove that knee into his chest coming off the ropes. Travis is down and he was stunned. That hit him right around the heart area. Idol sets up a boot to the side of the ribcage. It has Travis in trouble. Idol crashes down that knee into the throat once again. Travis gamely trying to get up, caught in the back again. Idol again drives a knee into the back of Steve Travis. Idol caught him with a hard, jarring right hand. Blocked by Travis that time, and Travis retaliates. Travis firing back, and Idol in trouble. And it is Travis now throwing caution to the winds. Steve Travis arm whips to the far turnbuckle. Caught a double leg dive. Foot on the rope. His foot was on the rope. No, sir. No, sir, he did not win it. Travis in behind him. A rolling reverse. No, sir. Idol powered out of that one. Travis brings him up a full body slam. The television champion into the lateral press. Idol powers out once again. Idol over to the ropes, and time is rapidly running out. Caught him with a flying bulldog. Idol in trouble. He's on the ropes again. On the ropes again. And so Steve Travis... Time is rapidly running out, and time is on Travis's side. Travis hurtled into that turnbuckle, dropped to the canvas. Idol again crashes down. Travis rolls out of the way just in time. Travis catches him in the midsection. Steve Travis, the television champion. Idol brings him up. Down on that knee, and Travis has got to be in a lot of pain from that. Travis in a lot of pain. Idol going for the Las Vegas leg lock. Travis caught in the leg lock. Steve Travis is caught in the leg lock, and he is conceding. He is conceding. The referee trying to break the hold. Austin Idol clamping down. Wait a minute. Kevin Sullivan, who apparently had been in the shower, catches Austin Idol. A drop kick, and it is Idol. Idol going for the figure four, but Kevin Sullivan breaks it up, and Austin Idol beats a hasty retreat. Austin Idol beating a hasty retreat, but he had defeated.
Thanks for watching Georgia Championship Wrestling. The announcers on this program were employed by Georgia Championship Wrestling Incorporated. Join us next time for more action and excitement. The top wrestlers in the world today on Georgia Championship Wrestling.